In the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God,
have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
to know your Son, Jesus, to be the way, the truth, and the life, that we may boldly confess him to be the Christ and steadfastly walk in the way that leads to life eternal. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Old Testament reading for the 13th Sunday after Pentecost is from Isaiah, chapter 51. Listen to me, you who pursue righteousness, you who seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham your father, and to Sarah who bore you. For he was but one when I called him, that I might bless him and multiply him. For the Lord comforts Zion. He comforts all her waste places and makes her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the voice of song. Give attention to me, my people, and give ear to me, my nation. For a law will go out from me, and I will set my justice for a light to the people. My righteousness draws near. My salvation has gone out, and my arms will judge the people. The coastlands hope for me, and for my arm they wait. Lift up your eyes to the heavens, and look at the earth beneath. For the heavens vanish like smoke, the earth will wear out like a garment. And they who dwell in it will die in like manner. But my salvation will be forever, and my righteousness will never be dismayed. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Contributes in generosity, the one who leads with zeal, the the one who does acts of mercy with charity. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
gospel readings over the past 3 weeks have each taught us about a specific aspect of Jesus' person and work. 3 weeks ago was the feeding of the 5,000, where we learned that Jesus is our great preserver, giving us what we need to support our body and soul. 2 weeks ago was the miracle of the walking on water and saving of doubting Peter, where we learned that Jesus is our Savior, giving us forgiveness and salvation from our fears and what could harm us. Last week was the faith of the Canaanite woman, where we learned that Jesus is the Lord, Son of David, and Messiah, who has come to save the whole world and gives gifts from his great feast to the whole world. Today, in our gospel reading, we reach a climax concerning Jesus' person and work. This climax is that Jesus builds his church upon the confession that he is the Christ. This climactic confession could not have occurred under more confusing circumstances, though. Jesus and his disciples are far north in the region of Caesarea Philippi, also known as Pontius. Caesarea Philippi was the supposed mythical home of the goat-legged, horned Greek god Pan. Pagan worship of this Greek god involved acts that dare not be mentioned from this pulpit. There's a reason that artists sometimes portray the devil as having horns and looking like a goat, because of the evil connections between the devil and this Greek god Pan. The fact that Jesus brought his disciples to Caesarea Philippi would have raised a lot of questions among his thousands of followers and even among his 12 disciples themselves. And then, once in the pagan region, the confusion only continues. Jesus asks his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" Jesus, of course, is asking about himself. But since when has he ever cared what other people think of him? Nonetheless, his disciples summarize what the prevailing opinions are about Jesus. John the Baptist, Elijah, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. These answers all have one thing in common. These are all people associated with the great last day of judgment. After all, John the Baptist's birth involved the first speaking of God in over 400 years. Plus, John the Baptist's preaching declared judgment on religious and political leaders alike. Elijah, of course, did not die, but was carried to heaven in a chariot of fire. And so it was believed that he would come again on the last day and bring all believers to heaven. And Jeremiah was the prophet who witnessed firsthand the fall of Jerusalem in 587 BC, which at that time was the last day type event for the Israelites. In sum, people are expecting Jesus to be the last day leader who overpowers the religious and political authorities and leads the faithful into heaven. And so the confusion continues for the disciples. But instead, Jesus asks them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter, speaking for all the disciples, steps forward and summarizes all that they've learned recently about this Jesus, whom they've been following throughout his ministry. In words that could have only been revealed and given to Peter by God himself, he confesses, "You are the Christ, Son, living God." The second part of this confession is nothing new for the disciples. They already confessed Jesus to be the Son of God after his miracle of walking on water. By adding the adjective living, they're merely saying that God, and so also the Son of God, is the source of life. He's the true God, not some false God like Pan. So that means it's the first part of this confession which is more important. The disciples confess that Jesus is Christ. He is promised Messiah. Christ is a title, meaning anointed one. And the Hebrew word for that is Messiah. Throughout biblical history, three groups of people were anointed: prophets, priests, and kings. So Jesus is not some judgment day religious or political relic. He's a prophet, meaning he proclaims God's word to people. He's a priest, meaning he intercedes for people with God. And he's a king, meaning he rules a kingdom made up of specific people. Altogether, confessing Jesus as the Christ means that the Son of God, the King of Kings himself, is in the world to declare and teach the word and save humanity from sin, interceding for the whole world with God in order that they might be reconciled to him. In the midst of all the confusion, there is no clearer confession about Jesus and his person and work. For this confession, Jesus declares that the disciples are blessed. And what follows this climactic confession reveals the wisdom and knowledge of Jesus regarding how he builds his church. He is, after all, a skilled carpenter by trade. Jesus declares, "On this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against me." The rock that Jesus refers to is not a man, especially not Simon Peter, as the Roman Catholic Church would want us to believe. Rather, the rock is the confession that Jesus is the Christ. Additionally, this is the first time that the term church is even used or ever used in the New Testament. And so Jesus can define and build the church however he desires. So at its most basic level, the church is made up of all those believers who have faith and confess that Jesus is the Christ, that he is the promised Messiah and Savior of the whole world. Members of the church have never been able to make this confession by their own reason or flesh or blood, but have always been given faith by the Holy Spirit to know and confess that Jesus is the Christ. And as a group of believers who make that confession, members of the church also desire to hear God's word, which further teaches about Christ. Members of the church pray to Jesus, who intercedes for them with his Father. Members of the church also become citizens of Christ's kingdom through baptism, and they continue to exercise their citizenship through partaking of the Lord's Supper. And above all, members of the church have faith that because Jesus is the Christ, his sacrificial death on the cross makes them righteous there's a lot that goes into being a member of the church. But ultimately, when you boil it down, what matters most is confessing that Jesus is the Christ. Many people even make that confession in confusing circumstances. Among pagans and idol worshipers. In the midst of people who say practically anything about Jesus. Just like the disciples in Caesarea Philippi. But the good news is that that confession does not come from inside us, but is given by the Holy Spirit. There's nothing you or I need to do to become a member of Christ's church. For by Spirit-given faith, we are already a part of His church. And through being part of His church, Christ gives us certain gifts. Because He is the Christ and Savior, He could die for us and now has given you and I and all members of His church forgiveness of all our sins. Because He was raised to life after His death, He has now destroyed death and given all members of His church not only fellowship in His spiritual kingdom, but also citizenship and life everlasting in heaven. Because He is the Christ, He could defeat Satan on our behalf and has now given us relief from the power of the devil and from the gates of hell. And so the gospel closes with one other thing Jesus has built to His church. This is the office of the keys, utilized by Jesus' servants, His under-shepherds, His pastors. Jesus explains about this office: "I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." So this office works in that if there's a member of the church who is openly sinning and causing problems, Christ's servants can bind that person to their sin, both on earth and in heaven, in order to help bring that sinner to repentance, as well as to help heal and restore the church. That's one part of the office of the keys, and not often used. More commonly used, though, is that if any member of the church feels burdened by a particular sin, they can go to one of Christ's servants, confess and repent of their sins, and receive forgiveness from Christ Himself through His under-shepherd. That person is loose from their sins, both in heaven and on earth, meaning God remembers those sins no more. The office of the keys, therefore, is how Jesus continues to provide direct pastoral care to His church through His servants. And so, altogether, we've now come to the climax of a month's worth of gospel readings teaching about Jesus' person and work. So today, from the confession of St. Peter, we have learned that Jesus is the Christ, meaning He is our prophet, priest, and king, and He has also built us and all those who confess that Jesus is the Christ into His church, which He continues to shower us with many blessings, won by His work on our behalf. To Christ be all the glory. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Steve and Jackie Vieira. in peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the church throughout the world, that built on the confession of the gospel and assured that the gates of hell will not overcome it, we may have the faith and courage to confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the church, that we may not conform to the world, but instead proclaim thanksgiving to God and tell of all his wondrous works, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the office of the keys may be honored among us, that we may confess our sin and be absolved in Christ's name, and that we may forgive others as he has forgiven us. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all families, children, single adults, and youth, and for those who teach and those who learn, that they may advance in wisdom and grace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For victims of violence and oppression, and for those who live with injustice and fear, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all nations and their leaders, that they may act for peace and promote godliness, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For victims of disaster and those stricken by illness or infirmity, for the aged and infirm, and for those who grieve, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our shut-ins, Bill, Brenda, Patricia, Sonia, Anne, Sophie, Paul, Jacqueline, Marilyn, Lamira, Anita, Esther, Roy and Marjorie, Klaus, Larry, Elaine, Sharon, and Emma, as well as for Steve and Jack. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For repentance and faith as we approach the Lord's table, that we may not think more highly of ourselves than is right, but that we would set our hearts and minds on the things of God. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For from you and through you and to you are all things. To you, O Father, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, be glory now and forever.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death, will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
Thank you.
Father, the fountain and source of all good, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh. We thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Thank you.
announcements today. Hopefully many of you saw the flock notes that I sent out on Friday. Beware of any scams that may text you or call you, pretending to be me, asking for money or gift cards. It is not me. I will not text you or call you asking for money, not even for somebody at the hospital or something like that. There's other ways to do that. So don't fall for those. Don't give them any money. Don't even respond to them. And then also I want to thank those who were involved. As you know, or maybe you can see, we didn't really have somebody up there playing the organ. David Bunting is away, and so we're trying out the SOS system for the organ on the fancy little iPad. So thank you for your cooperation with that. Thank you to those who helped out with doing it. And I think we'll give it a try next week as well. So just thank you for that. I look forward to greeting you in the back.
My wife loves it. I love it.